What's going on, my fellow rock and rollers? Saturday Night Live is without a doubt one of the greatest late night shows of all time, in my humble opinion. And while the show's quality varies greatly season to season or even decade to decade, it's brought us some great musical moments over the years. It seems like when a musical guest gets the highly coveted spot on the show, it generally means that they've probably made it. Now, some bands choose to embrace the opportunity, while others choke or just commit acts of self-sabotage, and The Replacements were one of those bands. There's been countless groups over the years who have been banned from the show, including Rage Against the Machine, Elvis Costello, and of course The Replacements would soon join that list in 1986. And The Replacements were a hugely influential band in the world of alternative rock, and were not just well known for their music, but their volatile and destructive behavior. The Replacements played an integral part in pioneering alternative rock in the 1980s, with their shows garnering a reputation for their chaotic nature and just total madness. In the run-up to their appearance on SNL in 1986, the band seemed to be raising their profile, releasing their major label debut, Tim, in 1985, and they were soon being managed by a big New York management company called High Noon. The offer to play SNL, in some respects, almost seemed like a life preserver given that Tim was loved by critics, but struggled commercially. The album by Christmas of 1985 hadn't even cracked the Billboard 200 and only sold about 30,000 copies 4 months after its release. And the band's label knew they had to get the band on television to revive what they saw as a dying record. And up until that point in the band's career, they had a very hardline stance against doing music videos, and the group's singer Paul Westerberg and the band's advisor Peter Jespersen would be summoned to meet with their label in California in an effort to change their stance on making music videos. Now, a band is only as strong as their weakest member, and guitarist Bob Stinson was an absolute mess. Struggling from drug and alcohol addiction, in addition to mental health issues, seemed to be dragging the band towards an early death. The band essentially recorded Tim as a trio, as the group had already begun rehearsing without Bob, and Bob's problems were on full display the night The Replacements played on SNL. The Replacements weren't even the original musical guests that night. They were, as some people would say, replacements. Nice pun, right guys? The Replacements were last-minute stand-ins for the Pointer Sisters, who canceled their appearance a few days before the show was set to air. And G.E. Smith, who was SNL's musical director at the time, was asked to choose a new musical guest, and he just so happened to be a huge Replacements fan. Actor Harry Dean Stanton would host the night The Replacements appeared on the program, and the actor, who was almost 60 by the time of his appearance, was having a career resurgence. The episode would also feature stand-up comic Sam Kinison, who was highly controversial, so what could go wrong, right? SNL had a wild reputation for their backstage excesses, but by the 80s, things had changed. When The Replacements showed up in the morning for rehearsals that week, both the cast and staff were appalled by Bob's behavior. Instead of drugs flowing freely around the dressing rooms like in the 70s, the rooms were full of breakfast foods and drinks like fruits and juices, but Bob requested beer, so the band's advisor Jespersen would head down to a local store to grab a six-pack. And on top of that, the band's crew members also smuggled drugs into the dressing room, and they would spend a few hours drinking and getting high, while also hanging out with the show's host that night. The band would end up playing two songs that night, including Bastards of Young and Kiss Me on the Bus. And as the group played the first notes of Bastards of Young, the audience, both in the studio and at home, were surprised at the volume the band was playing at. Following a reasonably good dress rehearsal, the Replacements secretly turned up their amps, and it would take a few moments for the show's audio engineers to turn the volume down. During the first song, bassist Tommy Stinson was mostly out of the frame for the performance, while brother Bob Stinson looked like he was trying to wrestle his guitar. It was made all the more funny by his feminine outfit he was wearing. When the Replacements hit the stage, the band was heavily intoxicated, with Westerberg walking away from the mic several times during Bastards of Young, with Westerberg claiming the band pretended that they weren't even on camera. And at one point, Westerberg can see mouthing to Bob Stinson off mic, saying, "Come on, effer." Westerberg would claim the words weren't said in anger or against the censors, but as a rallying cry for his band to give their best performances. But the NBC bosses didn't see it that way, and frankly, they should have called it quits right there, but they didn't. And following the first song, Tommy and Paul bowed to the crowd, while Bob followed with a backward somersault, showing a tear in his pants, and his bare ass flashed briefly on the screen. The crowd seemed to eat it up, and while many at home may have missed Paul's profanity or Bob's butt, show producer Lorne Michaels didn't. SNL up until that point had a long history with the F-word, as 5 years prior in 1981, cast member Charles Rocket accidentally said it during a spoof of the TV show Dallas, and the slip-up resulted in rockets firing and tons of unwanted press for the show. And Michaels would tell Rolling Stone, "The whole deal with the network, in my mind, is that we operate on a level of trust. We have live air." Not helping the situation was that SNL's popularity had taken a dip around this time, and some local affiliates and markets weren't even broadcasting the show live, resulting in the show airing even later than normal. So of course, show producer Lorne Michaels was worried that any controversy could result in the show being canceled. And following the band's first song, the Replacements thought they had given a great performance. The crowd agreed, and there was a ton of shaking hands and high fives backstage. Then the Replacements' co-managers Russ Rieger and Gary Hobib were told that Lorne Michaels wanted to speak with them, and they thought Michaels would come by to congratulate the band. Instead, Michaels stormed up and began to yell at Rieger loudly, saying, "How dare you do this? Do you know what you just did to this show? Your band will never perform on television again," he'd say. And Rieger, for his part, started apologizing, but Michaels refused to back down. And to make matters worse, during Michaels' meltdown, he noticed that the Replacements had redecorated the dressing room and lost it even more. Now, unfortunately for Michaels and the NBC censors, the Replacements still had one more song to do. And reeling from the Michaels tirade, the band screwed up the counting to Kiss Me on the Bus and had to start the song twice. While the Replacements' managers were shaken up by Lorne Michaels' tirade, the members of the Replacements wanted to have some fun as they hit the stage for their second song, Kiss Me on the Bus. Members Paul, Tommy, and Chris had all changed clothes with each other, with Bob Stinson remembering, "I was in the bathroom getting high. I had no idea those three had switched clothes. I didn't even know until I saw the playback," he'd say. Now, Michaels and the network censors watched nervously as Tommy Stinson walked over to Westerberg's microphone, and he would tease the censors, mouthing the words, "Darn it." And following the performance, Bob threw his guitar behind his head, and it would crash, resulting in a large amount of feedback. And Westerberg probably said it best looking back at that performance, recalling, "Rock and roll doesn't always make for great television, but we were trying to do whatever possible to make sure that was a memorable evening," he'd say. And following the show's closing credits, the band and their entourage headed to Café Luxembourg for the post-show party, and Michaels once again ran into one of the Replacements' co-managers and dressed him down again in front of a group of people. The cast had reportedly ignored the band, with Bob Stinson remembering, "They put their noses up at us and we spit up their nose hole," he'd say. And the following Monday, Lorne Michaels would get an $1,100 bill for the hotel damages the band had left behind. This would result in Michaels threatening to ban any band from the label Warner Brothers from appearing on the show, but things would eventually be worked out between the label and SNL. And almost 30 years after the Replacements were banned from SNL, the band made their long-awaited return to the NBC studios in 2014 when they appeared on The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon. That does it for today's story, guys. Thanks for watching. Be sure to like button and subscribe. And as always, if you have suggestions for future topics, let me know in the comments section below. Take care.